Okay, so again, I'd like to invite all participants, including Informed Action Civics in the back, to come take a seat. In the front, Mr. Loewen said. So my name is Olivia Santillan, and I want to welcome you here tonight to our first annual Civic Engagement Expo at the Santa Clara County Office of Education. And I would like to thank you for being here. And I'm really excited to see everything we have in the room. And I'm especially excited to see we have students here who are sharing their work with us. Yes, let's give them a round of applause. And to support our efforts, I'd also like to share that we do have a Twitter page at Civic Santa Clara. And if you haven't noticed yet, we have a Twitter wall out there where you could create a tweet outside of the San Jose room and post it, and it's going to show up on our live Twitter feed. So at Civic Santa Clara, and that way you can follow all of our efforts promoting civic education and civic engagement in Santa Clara County and throughout Region 5. And so to get started tonight, I'd like to introduce Dr. Dewan, our superintendent, and she's going to welcome you to this evening's event.
Good evening. Good evening. When I was sharing earlier in the week with our County Board of Education members about tonight's effort, I said, and I meant it sincerely, I couldn't think of a better way to spend a Friday evening than with a group of educators and students talking about democracy and civic engagement. And it really is my pleasure to welcome all of you. And as Olivia shared, this is the first annual Civic Engagement Expo, an event that we intend to invest in and to host annually. At our office, we're committed to fostering an understanding of our democracy and its structures and processes by sharing resources, identifying best practices, and encouraging informed civic participation. We know that that's really the cornerstone of our democracy. If we don't know how to have civil discourse, if we don't know how to identify the information that goes behind what we're advocating for, we will fail as a democracy. So these types of things that we do together are so important. And this expo is one of those components of our commitment to this effort. I wanted to share just a little quote. Some of you may have seen the movie Wonder. Anybody see it? Any of the kids see it? Tearjerker of a movie. If you haven't seen it, please look it up. It talks about the importance of being kind in our world. And the teacher in the movie uses precepts each day to teach students about character and about values and about democracy. And I was so intrigued by Mr. Brown, the teacher in the movie, that I purchased his book, The 365 Days of Wonder, and it has a different precept for each day of the year. At the beginning of the book, it says, "Teach him then the sayings of the past, so that he may become a good example for the children. No one is born wise." I think that really speaks to what we're trying to do tonight. None of us are born wise. We're not born knowing how to be a citizen. We're not born knowing how to participate in our democracy. And sometimes we're not actually even aware of the importance and the value of democracy. It's just what we've always known. A commitment to democracy and civics education is a collective effort, which is why I'm so pleased to be here tonight and to be able to recognize all the efforts throughout Region 5, which includes Monterey County, San Benito, and Santa Cruz County Offices of Education. I'd also like to thank our invaluable partners. We have four cornerstones, four principles at our office: equity, diversity, inclusion, and partnership, because we know no good work is done alone, only in partnership. And so our partners include the University of California, Santa Cruz History Social Science Project, and the UC Berkeley History Social Science Project. John Dewey once wrote, "Democracy has to be born anew every generation, and education is its midwife." As educators, we serve an important role in civic engagement to support our students and prepare them to have an active role and an active voice in our democracy. This is why this event is so important to me personally. Together, we share a responsibility to teach our students the importance and the privilege of civic participation and to help develop a deep understanding and a deep commitment as we prepare our next generation of leaders, thinkers, citizens, and future presidents. I'd also like to acknowledge our exhibitors, our speakers, the student panel, and our event participants who shared your knowledge, your ideas, and creativity. So please join me and give it all up for all the great people who are here today with some applause. You have much to be proud of. We are fostering a culture of learning that will carry forward through our respective programs and ultimately will impact the students that we serve. I do believe that together we can increase civic engagement, civic awareness, and education. We know that the young generations are historically the least likely to vote in our democracy. And we are on a mission to change that. We want our young people to register to vote, pre-register to vote when they're 16, register, be registered, start voting when you turn 18. Your voice matters, and young people can change the world. We want to make a difference in the lives of our young people so they feel confident and competent to participate in our voting elections. I'd also like to thank Teatro Campesino for joining us this evening, and we are looking forward to seeing and learning how to inspire civic action through creative performance. And so before I introduce our keynote speaker, I'd like to acknowledge the student winners of the Civic Engagement Student Poster Contest. So students, when I call your name, please come forward to accept a certificate and a prize. I might need a little assistance with this distribution, but I'd like to begin by asking Abigail Garrison to come forward. Abigail, are you here? Is Corinne Zhu here? Addison Ho? Or Juan Lee? Well, in absentia, we will celebrate them. We'll make sure to get their certificate. And if the traffic's been a problem and they arrive late, we'll circle back and join them. So now it is my great pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, James Loewen, author of Lies My Teacher Told Me. Please welcome James.
That was a great introduction. I always tell people to make it short, and by gosh, that was short, and thank you very much. I really appreciate that. I mean, the people who talk about my degree or whatever, who cares? I've seen a bunch of you because we just had a workshop on, which I could have called Lies My Teacher Told Me About Native Americans. I'm delighted to be here because talking to you folks is just exactly, you know, the audience that I wrote many of my books for. So I think what you do is important. I'm talking to the teachers. And you guys, you're still students, you get to force your teachers to, among other things, what you might want to do. I'm going to hold this up if I have a copy. Oh, I don't know what happened to my copy. Well, I did have a copy. There's a young people's edition of Lies My Teacher Told Me that's now out. I think maybe the person I rewarded with a free book this afternoon took it, and that's fine. I told her she could take it. But anyway, you could read the adult edition, but you can for sure read this younger people's edition. So you want to read it, and then if your history teacher later on, a year or two from now, doesn't measure up, well, then you hit them upside the head with my book, and you say, how come you don't know this stuff, you know? Okay, that's your job for the next year or two. I'm delighted with your emphasis on civics, on civic education, on the relationship of the past to the present, on the relationship of social justice to history and vice versa, okay? I now sign my email. I invented this about 2 years ago. I sign my email with the phrase, something like this. I don't know what it's, something like this. It goes, truth about the past helps cause justice in the present. Think about that. Justice in the present helps us write truth about the past. Okay? It's easier for us to see things in the past that were wrong once we fix them, all right? And so actually, for example, history and social studies textbooks do a halfway decent job dealing with slavery, because we did end slavery, didn't we, you know? But the R word, racism, racism, of course, was the handmaiden of slavery. Racism is the ideology of slavery. Let me explain that just for a minute, because a lot of people don't explicitly really understand this. There are people who don't know, and the textbooks don't say at all what causes racism. Okay? So some people of color actually think, well, all whites are racist by nature. Well, as a sociologist, we don't give natural explanations for anything. We know that explanations are social, they are historical. Right? So slavery comes about as the key, racism comes about as the key rationalization, the ideology to justify racially based slavery. Now, all societies had slavery. That's maybe not true, but all continents certainly had some slavery, almost all of them. Europeans were enslaving other Europeans. Africans were enslaving Africans. Native Americans were enslaving Native Americans. This is usually a result of warfare, and there's what's the concept of a just war or just enslavement. I don't believe in those concepts, but at least there's allegedly some justice in it, and then maybe you get traded back after some years because your group loses and has some exchanges to make or whatever. But the new racial slavery that came about as a result of the Portuguese cruising down Africa with armadas, with ships in such force that they could not be readily resisted, this was new. And the slavery that resulted was new in that the kids were enslaved to the nth generation, right? There's virtually no way out of slavery, virtually, okay, of this new slavery. So it could not be claimed to be just by anybody. And so this guy Montesquieu, I'm deliberately simplifying and mistranslating him, but this is what he said about it, and he nailed it. He's speaking kind of ironically, but he said, they, and in race relations and in history, we use the word they a lot, right? And you know who he's talking about with they already. He's, of course, talking about the Africans who are being enslaved. They must not be human, else we cannot be Christian. All right? So that's saying right off the bat, we are good people. We would never do this to people who are fully human. These people, and so we blame it on them. These people are inferior. Slavery is good for them. They need to be told. They even like to be told what to do. They, you know, it's a good thing. All right. Well, slavery disappears in 1863 in some parts of the United States, other parts 1864, 1865. Did you know that there was the enslavement of Native people in the West that went on really until 1865? It's pretty astonishing. A lot of people don't realize that. Okay. And so it ends. Does racism go away like that? Unfortunately, no. And in fact, it comes back in force in the era 1890 to 1940. I may or may not have time to show you this because I got 22 minutes to speak or something like that, and I have 65 minutes for you, and unless I talk really fast so you can't understand me, I won't be able to do it all. All right, so I think I won't. All right, so racism then is a product of history, and it goes up at times, and it goes down at times. Okay? It goes up after 1890 and stays high until 1940, and then it starts diminishing, okay, in 1940. And so this era, 1890 to 1940, is a particularly terrible era. It is called, we have a name for it, it is called the nadir of race relations. That's N-A-D-I-R. Some people say nadir, that's fine. That's a word, right? It means low point, opposite of zenith. The nadir of race relations is the period 1890 to 1940, when things got worse and worse and worse. Now, be careful. I already think I pointed this out this afternoon, but some of you weren't there. I'm not saying it's better to be a slave in 1855 than it is to be a black person alive in California in 1915. No, I'm not saying that. But I am saying that as an ideology, as a manner of thinking, we got more racist as a society during the nadir than at any other time. Well, unfortunately, that's when most of our history textbooks got set in their ways. Unfortunately, that's when many, many, in fact, maybe most of our monuments, certainly most of the Confederate monuments, went up between 1890 and 1940. This is when the monument of McKinley, that I think is under some duress now in California, went up. This is when all kinds of astoundingly racist and sorrowful people, in other ways, got their names on buildings and colleges all across the country and so on. So that's what we're dealing with. I'm actually going to skip all of this. I am going to show you this picture of racism. This is both the best curve, the best drawing you've ever seen of racism in the United States, and it's also completely incompetent. And I can say this because I did it. All right. What's incompetent about it? Well, you will notice that there is no axis. There's no units on the left-hand side. That's not so good. It's just kind of impressionistic. At the other side, at least I tried. Nobody else has ever tried to do this, OK? And there's a lot of information on here. And in particular, I'm showing the nadir of race relations right here. It goes up in 1890. And I want you, I want all of you to be sure you know what this era is. And I want to mention my books. Matter of fact, I'm going to, if you want, I don't want to fly with them. I'm taking the red eye back. I don't want to fly with them back, so I'll sell them at low prices. But I'm not here to flog my books. But anyway, Teaching What Really Happened, my book aimed at teachers. The last chapter is The Nadir and How to Know About It and How to Teach About It. All right. Also, my book Sundown Towns, I'm going to say a word about Sundown Towns, has chapter two is The Nadir, the birth era, the gestation period or something like that for sundown towns. You know what a sun, does everybody know what a sundown town is? A sundown town, some of you are shaking your head. A sundown town is a town that for many years was, and actually some still are, all white on purpose, okay? California was full of them. California in the 1870s threw Chinese Americans out of at least 50 cities and towns, okay? Wyoming threw Chinese Americans out of every county except one. Idaho, I had no idea of this. Idaho Territory in 1870 was 19% Chinese American. By 1990, by 18, did I say 1970? Let's try 1870. Idaho was a state by 1970. In 1870, Idaho Territory was 19% Chinese American. By 1890, just 20 years later, it was less than 1%. And then black folks get thrown out of cities and counties and towns across Montana, across the Upper Peninsula of Michigan, almost every single town in Oregon, 80% of the suburbs of Los Angeles, most of the Bay Area, except for San Francisco and Oakland, go sundown. Okay? The name comes from, and I'm going to use the N-word here. I am, of course, not saying it. I am quoting it from the sign, you understand. Hawthorne, California, is a suburb of Los Angeles was an example. It had a sign at its city limits into the 1960s, "Nigger, don't let the sun go down on you in Hawthorne." All right? That's where the term comes from. Lots of places don't use the term, don't know the term, but they sure are all white on purpose, or they were. Okay? Ferguson, Missouri, you've heard of Ferguson, Missouri? Now 67% black when it had its race riots of 4 years ago, but it was a sundown town briefly from 1940 to 1960. And it still had sundown town policing. So sundown towns are a product of the nadir, okay? And they are a northern phenomenon. They're all across. How many of you have ever seen the movie The Green Book? All right, I have to say one word about that then. It's not as bad a movie as people have been calling it out for being. It did win the Academy Award for Best Film, didn't it? Something like that. All right, but I gotta say something about it sociologically. This unlikely couple, which is a true couple, that's one of the reasons I sometimes defend the movie, depending on the issue being discussed. The white chauffeur, the black jazz pianist. They travel through Indiana, where there are at least 400 sundown towns. Illinois, where there are 506, and I know, because I'm from Illinois and I did the work. To Iowa, where there's at least 300 sundown towns. To St. Louis, to Mississippi, and in Mississippi, they find themselves in trouble because they're in a sundown town. You know how many sundown towns there are in Mississippi? I lived in Mississippi for 7 years, so I know. I did the research. There are 3 sundown towns in Mississippi. This compares to 506 in Illinois. How could they find one in Mississippi? There are hardly any there. Well, Hollywood knows. Hollywood has made 5 movies about sundown towns. 4 of them are set in Mississippi, where there aren't any, and 1 in Georgia, where there are hardly any. Okay, this is a northern phenomenon. There are more sundown towns in Oregon than in all of the South. But of course, Oregon doesn't have racism. California doesn't have racism. Illinois, Iowa, it is absurd. No, the nadir of race relations was national, and it messed up our public history in many ways. And I don't really have time to give you my talk about the nadir of race relations, so I'm skipping ahead. It's messed up on the landscape here in some ways, but I want to show it to you how it affects our public history in particular, because there's nothing been more in the public eye for the last 3 years than the statue of Robert E. Lee in Charlottesville, the famous taking down of the statues in New Orleans, right, the issues. And these issues are national, right? There's renamings going on all over the place, and there need to be. I'll give you just one example. You have some terrific renamings going on in California. But the University of Minnesota, the largest building on campus, the student union, is named for this great president who was president in the 30s and 40s, okay? And he threw black people off campus. They were living on campus. They were students, you know, living in student housing until he comes along during the nadir. And in 1930 or so, they can still go to the school, but they have to live in town, meaning probably living with a few black people who will take them in. There aren't too many black folks in Minneapolis, St. Paul at the time. They're taking his name off the student union. I think that's a good thing, especially if they then leave a big plaque saying, this building used to be called Culverd Hall, or whatever the guy's name was. It was named for this guy. He did the following good things for the university. He also segregated it, threw black folks off campus, and you know, it was named in the following year, and we removed the name in the following year because we didn't think that was right. Now that tells some history. Just putting his name on the building only says 2 things. He was a great man, and we should revere him, right? Putting Robert E. Lee on a horse, in fact, you'll see it in a minute. This is a typical Confederate statue before the nadir sets in, 1889. Would you call this triumphant? It's kind of pensive, isn't it? He's not sure this is the best idea. And around the base, there's the names of all the people from Arlington, from Alexandria, who died, okay? I actually have no problem at all with this monument. I think it should be in a cemetery. It's kind of in a main street. But even there, it's not my issue. This is a typical monument of the nadir. 1 year later, this is in Richmond, okay? Now, Robert E. Lee is on a horse I call Sylvester Stallion. You understand? I'm making a Rocky ear. I mean, this horse has muscles on its muscles, right? Doesn't look anything like Traveler, his horse. His feet, the horse's feet, are 40 feet up on the ground. We're supposed to put our hand, I don't know what we're supposed to do, but something like that. Revere the hell out of him, right? And all it says is Lee. It doesn't even say that we're revering him for being president of the, I mean, for being a chief general of the CSA Army. It doesn't tell any history except, look how great he is, we got to revere him, right? I submit it needs to come down. All of these statues need to come down and go to a park called the Nadir of Race Relations Park, because these are all artifacts of the nadir. And then you have a big plaque in front of them saying what this shows about 1922 when it went up, or in this case, 1890 when it went up, etc. And where it was, you say this went up in 1890, here's what they said at the dedication, and you should read some of the blood-chilling things that were said about race relations, about black people when they put up statues like this during the nadir. So these statues, I talked about historiography this afternoon. These statues are emblematic of the period of when they went up. They tell us something useful about 1890 to 1940. Typically, they don't tell us anything useful about the Civil War. So the cool thing, yesterday I was talking at a small school system here in California, and I talked about how you can get students questioning historical markers. And they pointed out there's a historical marker across the road. And damn, if one class hadn't gotten their students questioning it. Okay, it's a really nice marker about the missions, right? And they wanted, and so I suggested, and they're going to do it, I think, but that they have a contest to develop a counter marker. and put it up on cardboard at least, and then maybe get the state to put it up right next to this other marker, right? Say, in addition to this stuff, which is a product of when the marker went up in 1948 or whatever it was, here's some other facts you might want to know about the marker. So you can get your students doing that kind of thing, challenging monuments, challenging historical markers, maybe coming up with a hall of fame for your high school, and who should be in it? Is it just athletes? What makes somebody really outstanding? Why do we want to celebrate them? Fascinating conversations erupt amongst 8th graders or 11th graders or whatever, and they do good work. And even if you don't end up with a historical marker about your high school in front of it in bronze, you can put the suggestions on the, you know, on bronze cardboard in the corridor. All right, let's see what else we got. During the Nader, then, all kinds of statues go up that are total, well, I use the term BS. We defined it this afternoon. Bad sociology, okay? This is an example. This is a historical, almost all Confederate statues go up after 1890. Why is that? If you come to how many of you have been to DC and seen the Vietnam Veterans Memorial? This is an example. You put up statues after you win, and we lost that war. That statue did not go up. That statue is a gash in the earth, right? The Confederacy, or I really should call them the Neo-Confederates, they won the Civil War in 1890. Now, I know it ended in 1865, but they won it in 1890, and I'm speaking seriously here. Of course, they didn't get to reinstate slavery, but then slavery was but a mechanism for expressing and maintaining white supremacy. And in 1890, here's some of the ways they won it. First, they actually got to rename it. For a whole bunch of years thereafter, even in the North, it was called the war between, have you ever heard the phrase, the war between the states? Okay. Do you know that not one person used it while it was going on? While it was going on, it was called the Civil War, duh, you know? So this is nothing but bad history, okay? It's called anachronism. They also got to rename what it was about. And all the slides I skipped, many of them, had to do with why did the South secede? And if I had time, I would take you through that and see what you said. I will say this about it. Up until 4 years ago, audiences across the United States, including in California, because I've spoken here before, I do this referendum in which I say, why did the South secede? I generate four answers, and the majority answer until 4 years ago everywhere was the South seceded for states' rights. I don't have time to show you this. I'm going to just hector you with it. I hate to do that, but I just don't have time. That is total BS. The South seceded because they were against states' rights, and they tell you why. My source happens to be a book compiled by one of my favorite authors, me, the Confederate and Neo-Confederate Reader, which I and another guy are just on the 150th anniversary of the Civil War and of secession. We got it out in time. And it quotes all of the relevant sources. Every single state says why they seceded when they left the Union. And they seceded for slavery, duh. And they seceded against states' rights, and they tell you which states and which rights really upset them. They're in favor of what the federal government is doing on slavery, and they are against states' rights. All right, and yet these referenda I gave and that I didn't have time to give you showed 65% of people that I asked in, say, Long Beach or the Bay Area or African-American teachers majority in Memphis or Cleveland or North Dakota. These are some of the places I've asked this question. Only in the last 3 or 4 years has a majority move toward slavery. Okay? And that's good, because my gosh, you guys are teaching people who are going to be running the country 45 years from now. And we were already, as of 5 years ago, we were already 150 years after secession. You know, you'd think in 150 years we could get it right. But interestingly enough, we all got it right in 1860. Everybody knew why the South was seceding. They were seceding for slavery. They said so. That's what I'm quoting. It's in 1890 to 1940 that we got this wrong, during the Nader. That's when we start lying about it. And the textbooks are still lying about it or making it hopelessly murky. This is an outrage. Side note on that. Do you know that the textbooks that California adopts for K-12 in history, and every state adopts, are not written by their authors. Did you know that? I proved it. I actually got a front page story in the New York Times as a result. I proved it because one idiot publisher, Prentice Hall, what they do, they hire somebody to write the book. Who knows who they hire? Nobody knows who they hire. Well, I mean, Prentice Hall does know who the check's made out to, but it's not the people whose names are on the, so I called up the people whose names are on the book. In particular, Prentice Hall made the big mistake of hiring one person to write the new chapters for two different books. They just used him, his stuff, for two books. Okay? It went through two different copy editors, but for page after page, these two books are identical. Same pictures, same captions. One of them maybe has the word very in it because the copy editor took it out of the other one. Okay? So I called up the authors. I think we need to laugh, right? I'll tell you what happened. But one of the two authors was, pairs of authors, was Borsten and Kelly. Ever heard of Daniel Borsten? Twice Pulitzer Prize winner, Librarian of Congress. I couldn't call him up because he had just died. But I called up his co-author, Kelly. Kelly, Robin, somebody, Brooks Mather Kelly, that's his name. Formerly chief archivist at Yale. I called him up. I said, who wrote the recent chapters of your book, United States History? And he said, Borsten did it. And I said, but did you know that for page after page, it is identical to Pathways to the Present by these four authors, the most recent of whom is a distinguished, this is his title, distinguished professor of history at Miami University of Ohio. And he said, Kelly said, and I quote, oh no, that's terrible. Pretty soon he admits that Borsten didn't write it, that he didn't write it. Quote, Prentice Hall hired somebody to write it. I forget the man's name. So the author doesn't even know the name of the person who actually is the author. The author doesn't bother reading it. So then I called up the distinguished professor of history, Alan, I'm blanking on his last name, and that's just as well, of Pathways to the Present, right? And he actually knew who I was. He had read my book, Lies My Teacher Told Me, and reviewed it very favorably for the Guardian of England. So we had a nice conversation. And I said, so who wrote your book? And he implied that he did. And I said to him, did you know that for paragraph after paragraph, page after page, it's identical to this book by Borsten and Kelly? And he first tried to defend it. He said, I didn't even read that book. Oh, that's interesting. Pretty soon he admits he didn't write it. I said to him, aside from the fact that you didn't write it, what do you think about it as a work of history? And he said, and I quote, just a minute, let me get it down from the shelf. Meaning, how the hell would I know? It's not like I ever read my book. So that's the level of scholarship that we're dealing with these history textbooks. This is why it's so important that you get your students doing history. We don't need to read a 1,400-page or a 1,200-page book in American history. We've got the web. They can learn things on their own. They can do important local history. They can do local history on sundown towns, on all kinds of things around here, on historical markers. And they will end up civically engaged, making a difference, and also learning how to do research, both by oral history and by written history, using sources, and thinking about them. You need to ask your students to not only footnote, but also answer this question in a sentence in their footnote. Why is this source credible? Credible. Now, a KKK source may be credible. Depends on the question you're asking, right? There is a KKK source on Martin Luther King. I don't think the KKK is a credible source for Martin Luther King. If you're asking the question, what does the KKK of Arkansas think about X? A KKK source might be perfectly credible, right? So you can ask your students, why is your source credible? And that takes care of any problem you have. I mean, yes, the web has some utterly ridiculous sources, and that's one of its strengths. You know, your students can see the utter ridiculosity. I don't know if that's the word, but anyway. And they can avoid it just by being asked that question. Well, during the nadir of race relations, these go to their all-time high, these being lynchings, right? I have shown this picture and harsher pictures to fifth graders. They can handle them fine, okay? You obviously, you have to give this some context, and you don't want to. Well, I'll tell you one. Here's one teaching tip. I actually usually give workshops that involve my telling you teaching tips I stole from other teachers, from really good teachers. But this one I came up with on my own, and I'm going to tell it. I'm giving it to you free. Well, I guess you're paying me something. Anyway, here it comes. It happened from my first experience teaching fifth graders, which was in Stamford Middle School. In Stamford, that's with an M. I just spent 2 days at Stamford, but this is Stamford, Connecticut, okay, which has some of the richest people in America in North Stamford. These are stockbrokers and investment bankers and stuff, and some of the poorest, recent Haitian immigrants and other people living near the train station and stuff, all in one middle school. And my job was to teach the first fifth grade at 7:42 in the morning or whenever the heck it was, and the second one at 8:30, and the third one at 9:20, and so on until the end of the day, where I would have taught the whole seventh grade, right? And so before I started, the assistant principal who had engaged me said to me, well, now, Jim, what are you going to do with these kids? And I had this picture, and I had some other pictures, and I showed them to her and said, I'm going to show them these pictures. And her face fell, and she said, and I quote, oh, Jim, do you have to? Well, of course, any of you who know me knew that then I had to. But I did do this before I showed anything to the first class. I said to them, now listen to this. Some people tell me the fifth graders are not mature enough to handle the images I'm going to show you. What do you think happened? That they became twice as mature as you or me. They handled it fine, okay? So there's a free one. For that matter, you do it this way. In fact, I got this question 2 days ago from a woman who was scared about teaching slavery, partly because she's a white woman and her class is not white, partly white. But, and I said, maybe you start with a meta conversation. We have to talk about slavery. It has to be one of the 30 to 50 things we talk about in an American history course because it's so important. Some people tell me that a mixed class like this with different races, especially with a white lady teacher, that you guys can't be mature enough to handle it. What do you think is going to happen? They're going to handle it fine. Well, let's have a conversation about whether we are, and they'll handle it fine. That's a KKK picture from California. I'm going to say one thing about this. This is my favorite picture of the Nader. Did I show this afternoon? I thought so. Well, I won't talk about it at great length except to say that obviously we have a 5-year-old kid who's whipping this older black man. The verbiage at the bottom says, get up, uncle. Some of you who saw this afternoon can tell other people why he's saying uncle. This isn't the kid's uncle. But the reason that I'm showing it right now is because I showed this picture, of course, to the fifth grade at Stamford Middle School. And I didn't have any idea what was going to happen. I said, now imagine, I've walked them through the use of the word uncle, et cetera, but they described what they were seeing. And then I asked them, I said, now imagine you're that little boy. But 30 years have passed. You're now 34 years old, 35 years old. You're going through stuff in your grandma's attic, and you come upon this picture. What do you think? And a little boy sitting right about where you were, a little white boy, said, this is the first comment, he said, ooh, what was I thinking? 4 words and an ooh. Didn't he nail it? You know? And we went on from there. At the end of the day, the assistant principal said to me, and even put her hand on me like, oh, Jim, well, how did it go? Meaning, what catastrophe have you created for me that I have to mop up tomorrow? This is what assistant principals have to do, usually. And I told her what I just told you, and she said, I knew they could handle it. They can handle it. They can handle it just fine. All right, so let me finish up. I wonder if I have, yes, I do. This is an example of the terrible history that happened during the Nader. This is 1965, but we were still coming out of the Nader, and we are still, in many ways, coming out of the Nader with regard to why did the South secede. We came out of it about 4 years ago. This is at Gettysburg. This is South Carolina's monument at Gettysburg. Every state gets one monument if they had a soldier there. Look what it says. This is total doublespeak. It's totally ridiculous. That men of honor might forever know the responsibilities of freedom. Isn't that interesting? They seceded to maintain racial slavery forever. Dedicated white South, oh, they left that word out. dedicated white South Carolinians stood and were counted for their heritage and convictions, a little bit vague. Abiding faith in the sacredness of states' rights provided their, well, you know, in 1965, South Carolina was in favor of states' rights. They wanted to keep the United States government from forcing them to let blacks vote. They wanted to keep them from forcing them from to integrate their schools and so on. But in 1863, just the opposite. All right, I don't have time to really talk about this. I just want to say that besides the lies about history, all the way from Columbus to why the South seceded, to U.S. Grant as a president, to all kinds of things that we're still dealing with from the Nader, we're also dealing with sundown towns. And this is a map of probable sundown towns in the Central Valley. This is a map of probable sundown towns in the Bay Area. There's a list of probable sundown towns in California. It's actually a much longer list than that, but most of them have not been researched. At my website, there's a, yeah, some of you are looking to see if you can find your town, and that's why I took it off right now. Because if it's not on that map, that doesn't mean it's, or that list, that doesn't mean it's not a sundown town. It means nobody's told me about it yet. Nobody's done the research. At my website, and I'm going to finish up right now. At my website, there's a 3-page paper, how to confirm a sundown town. 3 fifth graders in eastern Ohio did this for 3 different towns there for National History Day. You know about National History Day? Ties in with some of your goals. And they won an excellent, and they got to go to the national, and they won an excellent there, okay? So fifth graders can nail sundown towns. That's one of the kinds of things they can do in terms of local history. Don't have time to explain those pictures. Just a couple other California references to the Nader. I'm talking here about eugenics, which California led in, you know. This is the president the first president of Stanford was a leader in causing sterilization in California of stupid people. I'm putting quotation marks around stupid people, I hope you realize. IQ tests, of course, they're Stanford-Binet. I have all kinds of things to say about the SAT. These are effects of the Nader that we're still dealing with today. All right, I think that's my talk. I just want to conclude by saying, you getting students to do thinking and researching about this, you guys can get the truth about the Nader out, and you can get your students so much more thoughtful about history than anybody else in California or in the United States, and I'm just looking forward to the future and to learning about how you do it in the next year or two. Thank you so much for your attention.
So as we were chatting earlier, we anticipated and hoped that one of our students or all of our student honorees might be able to join us yet this evening. And if in fact they did, we would circle back and celebrate them. So I do want to take a moment to do that. And also Olivia is going to put our schedule back up. But thank you so much for sharing your wisdom and your insights and really inspiring us all to think differently about how we engage our youth. Thank you. So the student honoree that we'd like to invite to come forward is Addison Ho. So Addison, we have some special gifts for you, some materials that you might enjoy reading to add to your library. You're so welcome. And we also have a special certificate. So I want to put my microphone down so I can shake your hand and give you your certificate.
Okay, so right now we are going to have dinner in the Guadalupe Room, which is just down this hallway to the left. And there's everything you need set up for you, water, salad, food. And we're also going to have our presenters back at their tables. And so you can also walk around, take time, learn about the different guests we have here today, and learn about the projects and the civic education and engagement opportunities. And we will reconvene at 6:30. Thank you. If I could get everybody's attention, we are going to move on to the next part of our program. Informed Action Civics, can you hear me? All right, so if we could regroup, we're going to move on with the program. If you could come and have a seat. Okay, so if everyone could come back to the chairs. Devin Hess, can you hear me? Devin, can you get everybody to come sit? Okay, so we're going to start off with Rachel Jung from the Registrar of Voters, Santa Clara County. She wants to make an important announcement about a legislative change. So if you could please welcome Rachel.
Thank you, Olivia, for letting me speak despite the last minute request. Hi, my name is Rachel Jung. I work as an election specialist and an outreach coordinator for the Santa Clara County Registrar of Voters Office. I thought while we are here with my coworker, Natalie Goldsby, in the back to represent our office, it might be the perfect audience to do a quick PSA on what's coming up and what's changing with how we vote in this county at Santa Clara County. So I don't know how many of you are aware of the Voters' Choice Act. It was a Senate bill that was passed in the California legislature 2 years back in 2017. It actually was implemented in five of the counties, Madera, Nevada, Napa, Sacramento, and San Mateo counties for the last two elections in 2018. And it will be implemented in our county here at Santa Clara County, along with five other counties like LA County, Orange County, Fresno County. And it will be covering more than 50% of California voters. And this bill is very, very important because it specifically in the law allows underrepresented voters and youth voters and voters who might not have had the access and the equal representation to be able to cast their ballots more easily and accessible in accessible ways. Sorry. So this new change is coming, but it will be very different in terms of how you vote, especially for folks who have been voting for decades in a particular way. You will no longer be voting that way. And there are multiple different changes in this step. And there's a whole presentation slide that needs to go along with it because it's so much of the changes. I know you've already gotten a taste of it with Shannon, our registrar, but I won't be doing that here today. But this is just a call for action, call for help, saying that as instructors and educators yourselves with influence to teach the young students there who will need to hear about these changes because it will be for many of them the first time to vote. And we want to make sure that this gets out in the right way the first time around so that when they decide to vote, they can actually cast their ballots in the correct way and they feel empowered and confident and competent to vote. So if you have any interest in working with our office to make sure that this curriculum is built and that we can reach out to maybe your classrooms or your schools to go out and do a presentation real quick, we'll be in the back, so just give us a note and we will contact you via email or phone number, whatever it may be. Thank you.
Okay, so next we have our panel discussion. So Dr. Dewan's going to facilitate that, and I'd like to invite our three panelists up to take a seat.
So I'm really excited. I've been looking forward to this all week. And really the purpose of our panel this evening is to talk about how we can more authentically engage our young people in civic civics works and in voting. And we do think that classrooms play a really important role in having the conversation, and that this conversation needs to be happening in classrooms throughout our county. And we think students, as our primary audience, really bring a lot of relevancy and authenticity to the conversation. And we often sit around trying to brainstorm and solve the problem. How are we going to get more young people to vote? How do we get them to be civically engaged? And part of our hope tonight is to learn from young people and the teachers who work most closely with them how to do this better. So I'd like to introduce our panelists. First of all, we have Evelyn Cervantes. Thank you. Welcome. And also joining us is Eduardo Valladares.
Valladares, thank you.
Thank you. And Jake Caldera Perry. And Jake is a student at Hartnell College. So again, thank you for joining us tonight. So one of the greatest challenges that our educators face is keeping civic learning engaging for our students. So my first question to the panelists is a two-part question. What are the biggest obstacles or challenges you see in getting young adults engaged? And what do you think might inspire greater civic involvement? We don't have to go in any particular order, so but we would like to hear from each of you.
Well, I'll go ahead and start. One of the biggest things is their peers. Oftentimes, students will join our program in their junior, senior year and say, man, I really wish I started in eighth grade. I really wish I started in sixth grade. But they didn't because they were worried about what their friends were going to say about them, that they were going to be laughed at, that it was too controversial, something they shouldn't step into because they're not ready for it. And in terms of inspiring greater civic involvement, food. If you offer food at your meetings, they will come. If they bring some friends, you encourage them to bring their friends, they will come, because that's one of the biggest things for people of my age group. Pride, knowing that they have done something, they have accomplished something. And then when teachers and other mentors recognize their achievements in a very real way.
That's great. Thank you so much, Jake. That's very insightful. Eduardo, do you have some thoughts on this?
Yeah, I asked my U.S. history class, my class is 11th grade, this question in terms of what are the biggest obstacles that are getting them involved. This is after already that they've done a timeline project. Looking at, you know, progress and what type of progress are we looking for, and what are some community issues. And one of them was actually judgment. You know, it was judgment from their peers. So I think that was very interesting to hear students feeling that their peers are not quite supporting them in that sense, or that they feel, and also another thing is some students don't feel quite empowered being under 18. They had mentioned that being minors, that they felt that was a major obstacle in that sense. But I think also real avenues where they feel empowered in their school. I think that's one of the main obstacles. I think if there's no real evidence that they are actually exercising any kind of power, it's kind of hard to actually believe that it can actually happen. So I've seen that as you know, being some of the obstacles that my students have faced.
I think for me, a funny story, I was actually part of that program too in high school. And I think meeting students where they are in their civic knowledge and interest more than anything, we have students that are, you know, totally ready to vote tomorrow. And I teach eighth grade, so, you know, it's not quite possible, but they're ready. And, you know, you have other students who are totally passionate about things. It's not that they're not, it's just they don't understand their civic, place in it. And I think we could start in the classroom more than anything, give them those examples of people that look like them, people that they can, you know, that reflect who they are. Be empowered in history or at least see how they've been putting up, you know, with the struggle, so that hopefully, you know, that also is inspiring. And then, I mean, the whole meeting them where they are, I think that's at least my personal one, where, like, you know, how do you catch them all? And I think to inspire them is definitely, you know, the great work that we've seen here today, like meet them where they are interested, if that makes sense, right? So ask them what they're all about, you know? And so they won't tell you minimum wage, they'll tell you, you know, my parents not being able to pay for rent or whatever, you know? And that's minimum wage, but they won't tell you that because they don't know. So I think the different levels of civic knowledge.
I think that's also very insightful. When we heard from young people why they didn't vote in the last election, many of them said that they didn't understand what was relevant on the ballot. They didn't understand what they might be voting for and how it connected to their lives. And secondly, they didn't know how to vote, just even the mechanics of voting. So knowing that that relevancy question and really how we help young people understand the connection between the items that they're voting about and the candidates they're voting about, what issues would you like to see more civic learning about?
Voting. The youth and government program really puts an emphasis on voting. We vote for our own officials within the program, our own youth governor, our own secretary general. It is entirely youth run and entirely youth voting. The Central Coast Salinas Valley delegation from the Monterey County pre-registered, 1,200 students to vote in the last 2 years of the, 1,900?
We should celebrate that. Congratulations. That's awesome.
And the delegation in Berkeley actually passed a measure in their county, the vote at 16. So now those students there can vote for their county measures, school board, sheriff, other county-related voting situations. And it's one of the most empowering things for them. But you'll find that a lot of the students don't really know that they can pre-register. Like you were saying earlier, they don't really know how to vote, don't know where to go, or what's relevant. So it's really just opening the doors to, hey, you can do this.
Do you think mock elections are helpful in that regard?
Absolutely, 100%. I know that the Constitution Project was a big thing for a lot of our students, and they really enjoyed that. They enjoyed learning about the process. The Buena Vista Middle School did a mock election as well, in which students had a wonderful, wonderful time, and they felt empowered after that.
That's great. Eduardo.
Yeah, I would definitely agree on voting, but specifically, I would say having students more civically engaged in their own education and how education works in that sense, and how their future vote is going to impact education in that sense. So, I know specifically at our school we have a predominantly Latinx community there, and what's interesting is in terms of the student body, the ASB. Is not necessarily the same percentage as the group. So I think those are some things that we have to kind of reflect on and look at that. But I think that's where, you know, I think I would love to see students more involved in terms of if they do see an issue that's going on in the educational system or in their school, what are ways that they could actually be empowered and actually see that change? And there's definitely avenues of doing that, but again, it's understanding student rights in that sense. And I think that eventually translates into, more civically engaged adults in the end.
I have to agree. Anything that's local, right, it's easier for them to see. Otherwise, it's far away. It doesn't matter. But, it totally does matter. I'm just saying, you know, it's easier to see if it's right there. The school, definitely local, right, district-wide. We have board meetings that, a lot of parents are not even aware that they can go and speak out on, right? And a lot of times they don't go and speak out on anything until it affects their community, until it's almost too late, if that makes sense. That's one forum that young people have as well, because the district works for them. And so we've totally had at San Jose Unified students come up and, you know, speak to the board. And specifically, my sister, who also went through youth and government, which she felt very empowered, and she had done it before, so giving them that practice, and then giving them the different options. So not necessarily pushing your agenda on them, but being like, hey, these are different options that you can go seek out and see what's going on in the district. You know, in the city, we also had the whole taking down of the Columbus statue, right? And so they could have the Columbus statue in the city hall, they could have gone in, if that was something that they were passionate about, they could have gone to the rally or gone and spoken at the city hall as well. So that those are all different options that are close to home and hopefully can inspire them to get involved.
I was really taken with what you were describing about the young people knowing about school board meetings and the agenda items and having an opportunity to come and speak before the board. And I think that also kind of raises a question, because there's ways to participate that are more or less authentic in terms of student voice. And so I just wonder if you have any thoughts about preparation for young people when they're getting ready to take on one of those actions to where they're really using their voice to talk about a particular item, perhaps, versus maybe the voice of the adults around them. Any thoughts on that?
Youth and Government's a great program. If they want to learn how to do that, a little bit of an ad there. Because we do teach them the process, and we encourage them to vote on what they think and what they believe rather than by party lines or by what their parents want or something like that. It comes from the mentors saying, yes, be you, vote you. Here's just how the formal way to do it.
Yeah, I think I feel as a teacher, I feel very responsible in making sure that students are equipped to actually speak their mind in that sense. So I think with that being on the forefront of that these skills are practical, that these skills are, they can be used, but actually making those, you know, mock situations so eventually you are in preparation, I think would be a next step in that sense, and having students just being very conscious of how powerful their voice are, you know, their voices, you know.
I think, and there's been studies on this, on how putting a student in a power position, right, in a position where they have a voice, they, later on, that student uses that same format in their lives, right? So just giving them that opportunity within the class. And then also with the mock debates or conversations, more than anything, it doesn't always have to be a debate, right? Bringing up controversial issues, sometimes even that don't make us as teachers or educators very comfortable, but giving them that experience, you know, and being able to see that some of their peers are not going to agree with them, even if they think they were completely correct. And that's the kind of stuff that happens at board meetings, right? There's every person that goes up to the mic believes they are correct. And so I think definitely making that happen in the classroom, even if it gets messy, even if it, you know, gets heated to a certain extent, there's a lot of scaffolding, and you can check out the back for, you know, for all those controversial issues. But actually giving them that opportunity and that experience in the classroom so that when they do go out there, they are not necessarily scared of the lashback that they might receive.
I also think there's some responsibility we all have as adults to ready the adults to hear from the students, and making sure that they're able to exercise their rights and use their voice in settings that are safe and encouraging of their civic participation. So I'm wondering, what can educators do to get students more involved in civic actions? So a little different than engagement, but really, you know, taking it to that next level towards action.
Well, you're absolutely right that the students need to be listened to, they need to be heard, because we've all experienced, right, you're really excited about something, you go to somebody who matters to you, and they just kind of dismiss it, and you're like, oh, well, guess I'm just not going to talk about it anymore. that sort of stuff really turns off students from wanting to pursue that avenue further, and you know, introduce them in terms of helping them be engaged in these action, introduce them to programs like Cal YMCA's Youth in Government or other youth in governments, the Panetta Institute, things like that, and facilitate and give them access to local officials. We have local officials like McShane, who is a city councilman. We have Robert Rivas, who comes to our local meetings. Jimmy Panetta's wife sits on our Y board, and she comes and she helps our delegates and helps them grow and learn. And when you see opportunities for them to get involved, show them. Encourage them to set up things like fire chapter, which tracks the money used in politics for the sake of transparency. Introduce them to those sort of things and say, any small step that you make in civic action is an action, because one step will lead to a bigger step and a bigger step and a bigger step.
Well said. Yeah, no, definitely. Ditto. No, I'm just saying. Yeah, I agree. I think it really has to do with opportunities. We need to find and make those opportunities for our students in class, and also give more opportunities outside of class, because that action can't just be done within class. And what are some other, you know, programs and opportunities outside to really cultivate that knowledge and understanding and practice? I think it definitely takes a community. And I think that schools as a whole need to be on the board of that. What does that look like after school? What does it look like before school? What is that? Because there's so many variables involved. But I think within the classroom, it's really about making sure you create those opportunities and meaningful opportunities for students. I think that's really the important thing. And again, guiding them on what are possible actions, because there's so many different avenues that you could take.
Yeah, and I think it was said great. In history, right, you want to give them those models. The fact that, you know, it wasn't just one great person that, you know, did fight for whatever, right? It's not one person ever that turns something. It's a movement, and it's people involved in that movement, right? And there's plenty of examples, but sadly, a lot of the history, as you guys heard before, can be a little murky. And then if we emphasize only people, like only individuals, then, you know, when I was younger, I thought that I needed to be the president of the United States to do anything important. And that's not the kind of message that we should be sending our students. So I think definitely giving them examples of how in the past people, you know, a people were the ones that created change, that's gonna start. And then again, giving them the opportunities within our classroom as well, like authentic opportunities. I haven't gone tuned in yet. I don't have it perfect, but like, you know, giving them assignments that are already civic action, if that makes sense, giving them options, whether it be, you know, like a letter to the editor of a newspaper, the local newspaper, if they see an article that is just false, or maybe they don't agree with what, you know, it's being said, that's civic action in itself. You know, educating others, that's civic action. So I think, you know, authentic assignments that already scaffold civic action for them and kind of force them to do it, you know, might as well do that. And I'm sure they'll find something that they're really passionate about and maybe in the future do it themselves.
Great. Any closing words from each of you? Anything you hoped you could share and you haven't yet?
Well, I was thinking about what you were saying. It takes a whole team of educators. You know, the saying, it takes a village to raise a child. Well, it takes a village to educate a child. So you work with your coworkers, your administration, with your outside organizations like the YMCA, the Panetta Institute. It's going to take a lot of teamwork to build that sort of foundation with your students, but it's going to pay off significantly in the long run.
Yeah, I think I think really that it takes a great deal of risk taking as a teacher to really take this step, because just like democracy, it's a little messy, you know, and there's going to be a lot of points of views, and you're not going to have the full control of the class, you know, to a certain extent. And I think that we have to be risk takers in that sense, and I think that's I love democracy, and I think, you know, we have to continue, you know, cultivating that through all throughout our educational system, and I think that's very important. And again, it's not easy. It's not an easy thing, but we have to definitely continue on with that struggle.
I think definitely working with your coworkers, anyone that's willing to meet up with you is great. I wouldn't have done half the things I did this year if it wasn't for my great team back there of eighth grade teachers. And then I blanked out. with having an authentic democratic classroom, I guess, also like as an educator, working with your students, which is risk-taking, right? It's definitely risk-taking, but because, you know, if you really want them to see what a democracy is like, and it's hard, don't get me wrong, but you're not gonna shut down their ideas or, you know, their complaints, which can be overwhelming just because you have to get through the content, which is hard, I understand. But, you know, that's something that that is definitely a struggle, like having that authentic, like letting go of authority and making the classroom a little bit more democratic, like what we're teaching them, I guess. I think that's a challenge too. So
I think teachers are risk takers and have a lot of courage every day. And it's like the daily disciplines of managing a classroom and managing curriculum and content. You know, it is a field of courage. And I just want to say that I think that type of courage is really the foundation of our democracy and really the place where we can ensure the protection of democracy is in classrooms with the work that teachers do as students. And I think our state is just about ready to recognize that in some meaningful ways with the new program, which will be the state seal of civic engagement, where schools will be able to adopt policies and students will have the opportunity to earn a special seal on their high school diploma around civic engagement. And I just think that's really a powerful statement that California is making about the importance of civics, and look forward to all of our teachers providing input into how that seal can be best earned in a very authentic way. So I want to thank you all for your time this evening. I think it was a very insightful panel, and congratulations for your input. Thank you.
Okay, so at this time, we are going to give El Teatro Campesino a few minutes to set up. And do you think like 5 minutes or so? 2 minutes, okay. So we'll be ready to go in about 2 minutes.